further ado, we're going to be bringing up a recording of the next talk, a speaker who is around for chat. This is a simulation with a view from Jonathan Lessard. And Jonathan is a game designer, researcher, and professor, longtime independent game developer, now focused on research creation in the field of simulations and emergent narratives. So let's go ahead and play that video.
Hi, everyone. My name is Jonathan Lessard. I should be here live, but I recorded this to make sure that I could, this would go smoothly and I wouldn't forget everything. So sorry about that. I wanted to talk to you about a project I've been working on for a while. It has many names. The last one is Divine Affaire. I'll show you that later. But mostly there are angles to this project that I find are possibly interesting for both roguelike players and roguelike developers. So hopefully that will be true. The title, A Simulation with a View, hopefully it'll make sense soon. So we start from this assumption that many roguelikes have an underlying simulation. Not all of them, or to a different extent, but definitely some of them have a very intense simulation, thinking of Dwarf Fortress, for example, Crusader Kings, not sure if it's a roguelike, The Sims, things like that. And in my case, when I began on this project, it was building a complex social simulation was one of my starting point. And this was my view a few years ago of trying to figure out what was happening under the hood. So yeah, tons of stuff is happening as simulations do. And, you know, in my case, I also had some intentions in terms of what I wanted to model. I wanted to try humbly to model the social conditions that led to the Neolithic Revolution in the story of humans and the history of humans. And, you know, I'm not sure I achieved it, but at least I informed myself as to social and ecological and anthropological mechanisms and stuff like that. But the truth is, most of that is pretty much unseen. So my first big question is, how will people know about all that? And I'm sure that resonates to some of you, that you have complex systems, but exposing them is a challenge, actually. So, I mean, the typical approach to roguelikes and games in general is that you have a game view, meaning that your exposure to the simulation is through what you're paying attention to and the information you get and the actions that you're undertaking. So that's what you can see. But obviously, you can't know or pay attention to what's outside your game view. So tons of stuff is missing from your attention, which is not an issue. It's designed on purpose because the positioning of the player as a limited awareness is definitely part of the game. But we could imagine something else. And there's also the issue of all the stuff that I missed in the past. Things all happen in the present. And if I missed something, then it's buried somewhere and I can't necessarily access it. So that's all lost. All lost opportunities to pay attention to what happened in the simulation. So my intuition was, first, what if everything was documented? I have training as a historian and definitely have this fantasy that if the world was all completely objectively documented in some huge archive, that would be really interesting. And I didn't make this up. I have these inspirations in mind when I start doing this. So the Dwarf Fortress Legend mode is a big one. James Ryan's work in general, but in particular, Dial, which outputs a whole simulation as a series of web pages. And to me, that's interesting. So that leads us to, okay, this is what the game looks like right now. And this would be something like the game view, as which is reminiscent of other things. But the new thing, the different thing that I want to introduce to you is these ideas of chronicles. So in this game, at any given moment, you can click on the chronicles down there and you have access to something like as exhaustive as possible Wikipedia of the world. And this is live, meaning that if you move forward in the game, all the information is updated. People who were alive are now dead. And you can get graphs, for example, in the world page, I can see like the fluctuations in human population, which can attract my attention to, okay, something happened here. Maybe I could go dig deeper and find out. Every person in the game, every character has their own little Wikipedia page with some biography, their current objectives, their current situation, even their face up there. So, like, information is there. You have, for example, it has multiple tabs. You can look at their family. So, this person has a husband right now, but two ex-husbands. So, I could also be curious as to what happened to them. They died. They died of what? What age were they? Oh, I can see their children here. And looking at the different last names, I see that possibly of different marriages. So, my curiosity can be aroused here. And then at the most granular level, for each character, I have the full timeline of their life. So all the simulated events are reported year by year, and then with hyperlinks. So, for example, here on the year 151, that character found a new mate, Benoît Souffrenoir. No, Benoît Souffrenoir is the person who introduced to the new mate, and the new mate is called Ludovic. And so I could click on Ludovic and find out about them. Then a bunch of other things happened that year, and of either sometimes of importance, sometimes of more trivial nature. But it's there. I can know. I can see. So this is my view to the simulation. Is the Chronicles gives me all this, and all most game objects also can generate graphs. For example, this character has had a big uptake in influence. Social influence somewhere around the year 116, 117. So once again, maybe a little lead to go figure out the story here. What happened? How did they, and then why did they lose influence? I could also cross-reference values, stuff like that. Which leads me to the other issue. Now, there's a lot of information being generated. That information is now accessible and to some extent parsable, legible. It's not easy, it's not hard to figure out. But the big question now is, why would people, players, care about all that information, all these fictional people, living or dead, and all the minute details of their lives? A big issue. I don't claim to have an answer to this. And the main approach that games have is to create a game around it. And we first made a game where you played one character in there, but the lives of the NPCs are not all that interesting. So I mean, it's unlikely that the one character will be interesting. But we thought it's kind of likely if you could look at many characters at once or had reasons to look at many characters, then you could find out possibly interesting emergent stories in there. So we were designing Divine Affaire as a god game, but literally you play one of the numerous gods in the simulation, and as everything else in the simulation, these gods are part of the simulation. They're created by groups of people, by communities as protector gods, and then they live in a relationship of reciprocal service where believers of these gods endow them with some energy, but in response the gods need to fulfill or are expected to fulfill the believer's desires or ambitions. So if I become, and so God of course has their own page. Right now it's not super sexy. This one, big story, they're currently associated to chins, and the ritual is to celebrate them by decorating a severe thong. Okay. Part of the fun thing is people communicate to you as a through prayers, but they fall like an email. So, for example, here Jessica is in love with Valerie, and she tells you that if you make this happen, she'll sacrifice some food for you. But if you don't make it happen, you have 5 years, then she'll be disappointed and it will make that disappointment known to her peers. So, you gotta do it, or at least she expects you to do it. So now you have a reason to go explore the situation. So I find out that these two people, they're actually pretty far away. So that might be one of the problems. Maybe worse is, one of them is definitely attracted to the other, but the other, not really. So that's an issue. But if I look deeper, I see that one of them, that Jessica, I think, has been pretty active in trying to seduce Valerie. So, I mean, It seems to be working not too bad. At least progress is happening. You see, Valerie blushes as she listens to the poetry I composed in her name. So it's going maybe not too bad. Whoops, I skipped one, but so maybe I can what I can do is I'll move you to intervene in the simulation by enacting miracles. And you have a bunch of possible miracles that you can do. And the thing here that I decide that I can do is at least move one of them to the other place and see what happens. But of course, I'm taking responsibility for this because, I mean, Valerie especially, she didn't ask for anything. So who am I to mess with her life? And so I decided to move Jessica, get like induce her to travel the world and go at the same place as Valerie. But the outcome was that she did move there. And then I can look at what, so I have this incentive also to look at the aftermath or what happened, or what are the consequences to my actions. So once again, I have to pay attention to the simulation here. And turns out that she didn't move there. She settled in that new place. She joined a new clan. But in that same year, the clan was attacked by another clan, the Steel Trappers of Grosshead. And so she was immediately involved in that battle. She was attacked by a certain Julian showbody and lost in the battle there and just died. So because of my action, she went to the other end of the world. She was immediately killed. And because she was far from her family and home, then nobody attended her funeral. Actually, like maybe one person. I don't know, but I wonder if that's her love interest. So that might be an interesting turnout. But I'm stopping here because you see the point. But the idea is that if by having instead of being a single player or a small group of player, having a top view, top-down view in the game, that as a role, then you have this opportunity and incentive to go explore the details of that story. All right, I'll stop here. Thank you, and hopefully there's some questions.
Excellent. Hello.
Hey.
I know, as you saw in chat, people were enjoying that. And yes, I think we have time for probably at least one question if anyone wants to submit one right away. I will say, I think people were asking in chat where they can get this game when it's ready.
Yeah, I wish I had something ready for this weekend. So I'll share. I saw that there's a place where we can share links. I can share I mean, there's my Twitter that you can follow. The itch page is almost ready, and I can put also maybe a Discord invite or something like that. So right, there's no clear way, but it should be around soonish.
Excellent. Cool. We'll include that and maybe put it in the description of the upload of this talk when it goes
Ah,
up.
good idea.
And
Thanks.
we have some questions right away. Thank you for that. Oh, we're getting lots of questions. I'm sorry, we won't have time to get all of them. I'm just going to pick the first one I saw show up from Aaron, which is how do you handle social structures in the game?
Ah, thanks for that question. Pretty happy about it. So, I read this book. I put it in the reference, Stone Age Economics, because right now things happen in the Stone Age or let's say Paleolithic, hoping to move it forward. But it's mostly structured around gift economy, and the basic notion is you give something to someone, and you get influence as an exchange from that. And from there, you can. It's like a fractal thing where when a family does this together, it has a social redistribution mechanism that happens. But when families do that between themselves, then you have a little higher social structure that happens between families that can form something like a clan. And when clans do that together, they can form something a bit higher, like a tribe. And when tribes do this together, it can be like a kingdom, so to speak. So it's like in terms of systems modeling, it's very pleasant because it's a one action that at very level pile up to become a full social structure. So it doesn't really show when you play the game, but to me it works. Like it makes the world very alive and people have relationships to each other just from this basic act. So there's stuff like that in there.
Yeah, that's really interesting. And I love from Roguelike Celebration when we hear about all these different kind of inspirations that people have for this, like, and you get kind of different flavors. We maybe have time for one more quick question from Hyper Gardens. What kind of decisions do you make as a player in the game, and how often do you decide the pacing of those decisions?
So the basic economy of the player is as a deity, you get action points, so to speak, or divine credit from sacrifices from your believers. And so at the beginning, you don't have that much, like you have maybe 20 people believe in you. You can just do a few miracles every year. So you have a limited action. And then as like the society grows, and if you do your job well, people talk about you and you get more well-known, then you have a little bit more action potential. But then you also, the world lives on without you. That's one of the things that I like. So you can just do nothing and hope for the best. It's like the simulation will just go ahead and move, and people will still believe in you anyways. But when you act, you're also taking some ethical decision and position yourself, say, okay, how much do I want to meddle in these people's lives? And will that pay off for me? But what does that mean for me as a payoff? Like, is someone paying the price for this? So it leaves a lot of room for sandboxy experiments as a day team.
Yeah, that's really interesting. And yeah, like some of that control of the pacing of how often do you want to intervene? Well, wonderful. Like there are some other discussions, but we'll have to save those for the breakout room. But thank you so much for joining us, Jonathan. That was a wonderful, concise and very interesting talk.
Thanks for having me. This conference is great.
Thank you.